After 14 weeks, cinemas have been given the green light to reopen their doors from the 4th of July.
And as one of the first major releases to hit the big screen post-coronavirus, Russell Crowe's new thriller Unhinged is the summer blockbuster we've all been waiting for.
Russell's are joining us from Sydney now. Welcome. So lovely to have you on the show. I mean, it's a brilliant trailer, actually, because it sets the scene rather beautifully. It centres around this road rage incident, as we saw in there, between Rachel and what we know simply as the man. Tell us a little bit about him, because you play him. He's a mysterious character.
Hello, Holly. How are you? I'm not actually Sydney. I'm in the bush.
Are you?
So able to hear your lovely introduction and see the photos of the doggies. So, you know, I'm out in the bush, of course. You know, you're talking cockachond.
Oh, God, you heard. Thought I'd got away with that one.
The birds that live around my farm, the sulfur-crested cockatoo, along with lorikeets and parakeets and king parrots, kookaburra, of course.
Of course.
Yes, anyway, on to the film. it's a very extreme ride, and it's full of tension. You know, it's funny playing characters like this, where normally my job is that I bring my bag of tricks along, and I'm trying to add the complexity, you know. I'm doing my research or whatever, and I'm trying to sort of build those tiny little emotional steps that keep people connected with the journey. But the challenge with this character is actually draining all of the humanity out of what you're doing, you know? There's no justification for this man's actions. You know, at first, when I read it, I didn't think I wanted to do it, but I started to realize that we're seeing these explosions of white-hot rage more and more in society. And, you know, this character uses his car as a weapon, but we've seen people walking into houses of worship and opening fire and schools and nightclubs. And more recently, we've seen people go crazy in supermarket aisles over a roll of toilet paper. Mm-hmm. So it just seems to be a place we've come to in Western society. And once I realized that I was afraid of the subject matter, it's just like a natural thing for me to go, well, that's the one I have to do.
Yeah.
Well, it's interesting because when I saw it, I thought, first of all, it reminded me a little bit of the, I think it was 1971, the Dennis Weaver Duel movie, which was amazing, the fight between the driver and the truck driver. And it was one of those just chance moments that escalates into something extraordinary. And that mix, and I think it was Derek Bort, the director, said that he's like Jaws. I mean, he is unpredictable, he's stealthy, he's lethal. And so that's a real mix. You never know how your day is going to go.
Yeah, it's interesting that you mentioned Jewel, because there were two very clear Spielberg references that we took on board as influences for the film, and they are Jewel and Jaws. And like you say, you know, this guy, there's no justification for his actions. There's not something that you find out about him that you bring any sympathy from the audience, you know. Just like the shark, you know, he's activated, he's at a certain place, and he's going to feed. And he's going to feed through this trail of destruction, which is, you know, it can't end in any other way than his own destruction with the way he's going about things. But, yeah, as I was saying before, you know, this sort of thing seems to be coming up more and more, and that's why it became an important thing for me to do, because it's commenting directly on that.
And in the trailer there as well, there's that moment where he sort of says to her, just apologise. Could things have been so different if that had happened in that moment?
In the world could be different.
Well, exactly.
We've almost forgotten to say sorry.
Well, there's this thing that place that we've reached, right, where it seems to be that people who are on opposite sides of a particular political question can't seem to have a polite conversation anymore. They can't seem to actually be able to discuss things through. They're so absolutely sure that their perspective is right. And as the guy says in the movie, you know, we've come to a place where we find it impossible to apologize to anyone for anything, you know. And I think it doesn't matter that it's this particular person. It doesn't matter what she's even said. Something was going to set this guy aflame. You know, he is already triggered before the narrative of the movie begins. And it just takes this small, innocuous event to turn this guy into this, you know, destructive ball of rage. And it's funny, you think, you know, decisions that people are making in various places around the world, and we see this white-hot rage more and more.
And you say, funnily enough, because for such an intense movie, and it is incredibly intense, that it was the most relaxed film set you've been on in 20 years.
Or more. It was just one of those funny things where there were so many people on that film who've spent a life in film, you know? Now, I know Derek, it's only his third or fourth feature, but he had a camera crew of incredible experience. He had a stunt crew, really, like if in the last 30 years, any movie that's had a car crash in it, one of these guys was on that film, you know what I mean? It was sort of, we're all just around the first AD, Steve Danton. Last time I worked with him, 1995, Virtuosity, me and Denzel Washington, you know? So it was a whole bunch of people who have had a life in film working on a low budget with a very compact schedule and just getting amongst it every day, you know? And you find yourself having these very perverse conversations where everybody's just, you know, very laconically and relaxed, you know, talking about today's the day we crush the people with the cement truck. Things like that. It's like, it gets very weird, you know? But yeah, it was, and mate, we were shot in New Orleans, you know? And, you know, it's one of the friendliest cities in the world, so it wasn't a bad atmosphere at all.
And so this is the first big film in cinemas, obviously post coronavirus here. Did they bring the release date forward a little bit to avoid the traffic? How did that work?
Yeah, well, that's probably a pun unintended, but a very very good way of describing exactly what happened. Because if you think about it, there is going to be a quote-unquote traffic jam with all these movies being held out. You know, you're now looking at a half a year of releases or more. So Solstice, the studio that made this film, is a very young studio. This is actually their first major release. But it's a studio full of a lot of very experienced people that come from all over the place, different studios and different backgrounds. And, you know, they looked at the landscape as it existed and as it was unfolding, and they've decided to take the risk to go first. You know, somebody's got to do it, you know. And the funny thing for me, I'm enjoying the fact that it seems so many people are missing going to the movies, you know. And the
absolutely.
Way I put that is that perverse sort of self-preservation thing that we humans do. We want to go back to the place where the crazy stuff happens on the screen, not
please.
Actually in our lives.
So true.
Tell me about it.
And I, you know, once the thought popped into my head, absolutely, I'm missing the movie experience too. I want to go back into that room and sit and watch a great story unfold and hear gasps and laughter around me.
No,
you know?
I agree.
It's sort of a really solid touchstone that's been in our lives for 100 years or more now, you know?
We may lose our, because we've got limited time with you, because I know you're doing a lot of interviews today, we may lose our line in the moment. I just wanted to ask you about your lockdown. You said you're in the Australian bush at the beginning. Is it your son's decided to stay in Sydney?
Yeah, they did. Well, you know, we don't have the same household anymore. You know, there's two households because I divorced their mum, and so they live a lot of the time with their mum. But there was the opportunity going into isolation for them to come to the bush, you know, which is totally set up for that kind of situation. But they both decided that they would prefer to stay in the big city, you know, surrounded by population because of their access to Uber Eats. So it was something I just had to take on the chin and deal with. But it's school holidays here at the moment, and things are significantly more relaxed than they were 3 months ago. So I'm hoping to see them very shortly.
Mad times, Russell.
Yeah.
We're glad you went first with this one. Can't wait to get back into the cinema. Unhinged is out in cinemas on the 31st of July, and it's lovely to talk to you.
Thank you.
It's lovely to see you both. All the very best and stay safe.
Thank you.
And you. Bye now. And you.